when I developed was developing Simply Music, there were several things. It was developed in a real-time, hands-on laboratory type of environment. I'm just going to see if I can get everybody on screen here. Yeah, it was done in a real-time, hands-on laboratory type environment where I was testing the content, developing the content. And as I was developing it, coming from this question of, you know, this is an idea. This is an idea that I have. Is it viable? Is it defensible? Can I structure it as a curriculum? Is it, how far can I take this before I have to start introducing more of the theoretical or mathematical aspects of music education? Would it apply in a cross-genre aspect or settings, meaning that is this an approach that would work with contemporary and classical and blues, et cetera, et cetera? So all of that was up for grabs and up for design. In addition to that, I'd already had this background where it's like I didn't want to be using music that was controlled by others. So it came down to I'm going to need to compose the content. And there were several obvious reasons why that was going to be very important. First and foremost, it gave us complete control over the intellectual property. But as importantly, I was also able to structure the composition specifically to what the learning tools or strategies were, you know, at any given time. And in the developing of the method, I had a fairly high output. When I'm focused, I'm very productive. And I was also working very, very long hours. A quiet week would be 80 hours a week, and it was very often 100 or well beyond. And so the momentum that I had in establishing the output of the content was really significant. And I'm also pouring out these compositions. And so as I'm doing that, there's just this aspect of it where it's like, well, what will I call this? And at the same point in time, there were also like memories that I was having. It's like, you know, what was I thinking about, or what was I relating this to? Now, it doesn't apply to absolutely everything. Although if we got into a different type of conversation, there's, you know, there's a rationale behind everything, but most of that gets revealed in the teacher training program. But there were simple things like, for example, the very first song in the curriculum, Dreams Come True, that really is the story of my wife and I. And for those of you who don't know, you know, I'm 62 this year. My wife is 61 this year. I met my wife on November 21st, 1970 at 2 p.m. She had just turned 12 years of age. I had just turned 13. So that was 17,569 days ago. So we're in our 49th year of this extraordinary friendship that we've had. She had been an exchange student and come to the United States in the mid 1970s to do her senior year at high school. And she had a very strange experience. In those days, the plane landed on the tarmac, and you walk down the steps. And when she stood on the tarmac in San Francisco, she was overwhelmed by this visceral experience that this is where she was supposed to be living. This is where she was meant to be. And I had also had this experience of growing up loving music. There was only, you know, there were so few media stations. We only had three television stations, or four later on. The only jazz on the radio was 1 hour in the evenings, from 11 p.m. to midnight. There was a show called Music to Midnight, and my mother would let me stay up and listen to that. If I wanted to buy an album, I, you know, had to catch a couple of buses and go into the local shopping center, place an order for an album. At some point in time, someone would put it on an actual ship, and it would be shipped across to Australia. And several months later, we'd get a phone call saying your album has arrived. And I always felt like, gosh, I wish I was closer to that music. And I knew that, you know, for me, the United States lived as the hub, the music hub of the world. And so it's like, I want to be around that. And so we had this shared dream from our teens of coming to live in the United States. So that whole idea of my wife and I being together with that, sitting here with you, which is exactly what it was like, nothing much to say. That's really just representative of just the ease that we had. You know, if for those of you that have been in that in a relationship where there's so much that can be communicated just in the quietness between you. that was really what that line was about. Listen to my thoughts. I've always thought too much. Pass the time away. This was the story of our decision. I like having dreams. Dream to be in the United States. One for me and you. It was a dream that we both shared. Think I'll make my dreams come true. That was really the genesis of the song. It was about our decision to come here to the United States. So that sort of represented a whole lot to us. And I love that it's the very first song of the curriculum. That just means something really, really special to me. So that's what that's about. In contrast, I don't think I talk all too much about my past, but there are aspects where I've had a pretty complicated past. I was a strange kid, and I had a lot of, I think I was very much, this is an exaggeration, but I was very much like house angel, street devil. I was always a social kid. I was always very polite and respectful and articulate and well-mannered. But underneath the surface, I was a pretty troubled kid. And I had a fascination with altered states from very, very early childhood. You know, I discovered dizziness. I could make myself into spin and spin and spin and spin until I was so dizzy I would collapse. And I just would bask in these moments, these seconds of euphoria as my brain was recovering from the dizziness. And then I'd stand up and just do it again. And that idea of that euphoria, I had this thing, you know, a lot of Australians, 97% of the Australian population lives on the coastline. And so it's normal for Australians to sort of be beach bodies. We live on the beach. And I had this thing that I could do where I could lie in the water and just roll and roll and roll and put myself into this trance state. And I would just do that for hours. This is a very young child. In my early teens, I started hiding drinking alcohol, and I would drink a lot of alcohol. You know, there were a bunch of us as school kids that we would get together and we would convince an adult to buy us beer, and then we'd go back and drink excessively and get drunk. And I did a lot of that. And there was a lot of my childhood where I felt very lonely and very alone. And it was a very confused child. And really the whole thing about Nightstorm was I had this relationship in the evenings of just lying in bed. And that whole thing about rolling thunder, clouds are coming. That was actually a metaphor for my state of mind, more than anything else. Looks like rain tonight. There was that darkness about Nightstorm tells more about the story of my state of mind. And that's actually, it shows up in several pieces throughout the curriculum that I'll probably get to. So there was absolutely and clearly an aspect of, from my point of view, of having heard so many other students that had learned piano lessons, and I would listen to what they were learning, and I thought the songs were just terrible. I felt that they were boring and uninteresting. There was no emotional or mood diversity. So one of the things in the developing of Simply Music that was very important to me was that I wanted children to have a variety of emotional experiences. You know, a lot of the pieces in entry-level programs that are geared to children have a certain playful mood, which is lovely, but that's not often the emotional experience of children. And so it was very important for me to have children experience emotional diversity in the pieces, but also given the fact that there are other family members that are listening to the music being played, I felt that it became a shared experience. And so it was really important to have emotional diversity. So even though we've got that story of just, you know, it just sounds like there's a storm coming, the reality of that song was that it spoke more to the darkness of my state of mind. I hope you don't mind me sharing all this. I don't mean for this to be TMI or too dark, but that's just, you know, you asked the question, so here I am telling you about it.
No, it's very interesting. Appreciate you hearing. I think students absolutely love to hear this, and I think it gives them inspiration as well.
And you look, and there's a certain aspect of that that's been entertaining as well, because teachers will write to me and they'll tell me what the students have said about what they think the songs mean. And I sort of chuckle to myself, and there are certain things that I'll go along with just because it's not the appropriate forum to be even sort of revealing the backstory. But yeah, there's a little more to it than meets the eye. Similarly with Jackson Blues, I mean, if we just look at the mood shift between Dreams Come True and Nightstorm, it's really significant, as is the case with Jackson Blues. And really the thing about that, the naming of Jackson Blues, as simple as it is, you know, there's nothing really, there's no story about the music other than I wanted a blues piece and it was critical that we worked with 1-4-5. I wanted to get that that left-hand stomp operational. We wanted to utilize the framework of chords. So there's all of that educational, obvious rationale. But the naming, quite simply, is that my father's name is John. However, everybody over his life called him Jack. And I'm his son, so I'm Jack's son, and that's where Jackson Blues came from. And probably a lot of you, you know that. I've actually got a list here. There's a list that we provide to everybody of all of the songs in the curriculum, organized by program, level 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, etc. And I'm just sort of going through the list here. So that's what I have in front of me. Honeydew, really the simplicity of that piece. I ate a lot of watermelon as a child, but we didn't have the same variety of access to fruits. And so the very first time that I tried cantaloupe, I thought it was a really weird flavor. It was such a difference. I was expecting, I don't know, orange flavored watermelons. But it was weird for me. And I really didn't develop a taste for cantaloupe until I was much, much older. And so as a child, I loved watermelon, but I didn't love that cantaloupe. But there was this time as a kid where I tried honeydew and I was shocked by how delicious it was. And it was just so sweet. And so really, as silly as it is, even though I've written the lyrics really about interpersonal relationships, the reality of it was I was struck by the beauty of the flavor and this incredible sweetness of the fruit. Yeah. And so very unsophisticated backstory, but that's the backstory. I had this 5-year-old student called Chester. He was amazing. He's in some of the testimonial videos. His learning experience of Simply Music was very, very different than our students, because when I was working with him, this was very much in development and I was teaching far more sophisticated songs. And this kid was just slamming them out.
Neil, he the one that plays I'll Be There, that little tiny kid?
No, that's...
I just like to put a face with it.
Yeah, that's the Kimes boy. He's beautiful. I used to call him Clip-On Boy because I'd pick him up and he'd just clip his around my waist and he would just sit there, this little... He was a great kid. But Chester's this blonde boy. I think in the testimonial videos, he's playing the full version of Fur Elise.
Oh, he's an older kid in there.
Yeah, that's his older brother, Sam.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah, I remember.
Yeah, but anyway, so this Chester chills out, that whole thing of, you know, one day I was walking down the street, felt my toes start freezing on my feet. There isn't any significant relevance to the story of Chester Chills Out. I really wrote the piece for him as a means of getting Five Steps of Sound working a little more. That was the intention behind it. And I, just because I knew he would be sort of tickled pink by this, I made the story about this groundhog and the groundhog's name was Chester. And he was like, oh my God, there's actually an animal named after me. He just thought that was fantastic. And that was the one and only story about Chester. As I said, even though I think that these things have valid educational value, that's the backstory. Bishop Street Blues, it's just a development of the blues structure, but the street that I grew up on was Bishop Street. And so I just called it Bishop Street Blues. And look, you know, if it's not obvious already, a lot of these names were, I've got the piece that I want to work with. Okay, what'll I call it? Well, I had Jackson. Well, you know, I could actually just name it after those things that are close to me. Yeah, I grew up on Bishop Street. Let's just call that Bishop Street Blues. And I also think too, when I was growing up, I was playing a lot of blues, and one of the pieces that I learned as a child was Basin Street Blues, And so I just borrowed from the street blues thing, and I thought, okay, I won't call it Basin Street, of course. I'll just call it Bishop Street Blues. So it was a little bit of throwback to my one of the songs that I was playing. By the time I was 11, I was playing pretty comprehensive blues arrangements of songs. And so that was just a little shout out to that. Similarly, even though it's not one of my pieces, of course, but I wanted to include Fur Elise because that was also one of the pieces that I played as a very young child. And people oftentimes dismiss Fur Elise, and I think it's an extraordinary, extraordinary piece. I heard a classical pianist once say, Fur Elise is, he was being interviewed and he said, Fur Elise, I'm going to mess up this, but you'll get the point. Fur Elise is so remarkable because it's so easy to play and so hard to play well. And I really liked that. I thought that was just a really cool thing. My mother's gone her whole life. Everyone, including my father, has called her Betty, which is short for Elizabeth, which is her second name. But her given name is Alma. And so Alma Mater Blues is Alma is my mother, Alma Mater. The other thing that's really cool about it, and this I just was shocked when I was looking up the words Alma Mater, that I learned that Alma Mater is the theme song of an educational institution. And I just thought that was like a wow moment. I'd already named it Alma Mater. I'd heard of the word. I didn't really know what an Alma Mater was, but I thought, okay, this would be really cool. I'll call it Alma Mater because Mater means mother. Alma is my mother. That's awesome. And then I looked it up and it's like, you're kidding. That's the name of an educational, the theme of an educational institution. I just thought that was one of those woo moments. Hey, are you hearing me okay? And can you hear the piano okay when I play?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, everything sounds great.
Okay, great, thank you. So basically that's a snapshot of the stuff in level one. I'll be there. Love that piece of music. I've got some real favorites in the curriculum. Those little ballad vignettes, I just have such a soft spot for those type of things. One of the challenges for me was, particularly that we're given, given that we're working with entry-level education, part of the challenge for me was I have to be very mindful and cognizant of the fact that we're dealing with students that are just building their physical skills and their relationship with the instrument. But I don't want these pieces to sound like they're childish and ordinary and boring. So the goal was, how can I get as much emotional diversity and emotional tension and release with as few notes as possible? And I think that's actually quite a challenge to achieve a musical sophistication with very few notes. And I like that about simple music, that a lot of these simple ballads are sweet and they have a nice richness about it. That whole thing here about, you know, this is my life to live, something to share, something to give. I'm really talking to my wife here. Maybe one day you'll need a friend, call me and I'll be there. That whole thing about maybe one day you'll need a friend. I mean, it really, I was also very aware of the fact I'm aware of the fact that parents are having their children in lessons and I'm giving them these pieces that have emotional maturity, but I also wanted there to be a message that they felt would be important for a child to learn. So the idea of having the dreams and making it come through, the idea of, being able to be at peace in bed in the evening and listen to the night, the idea of reaching out to a friend and as an act of loyalty. I just like the messages of those things. But at the same point of time, really what I'm saying is to my wife is that till the day I die, I'll be your friend. Anyway, the other thing that I just want to point out is that there's this what's the word for it? I don't know. There's this thing that I really like, and I use it all the time, and it's woven throughout the pieces. And that's where I have one of the inner voicings. If we look at I'll Be There, we've got this. We've got this A to the A flat to the G, where there's this descending, there's this chromatic descent that is occurring. And that is woven in lots and lots of places throughout the curriculum. There's something emotionally that I draw on with regards to that. So I just wanted to point that out, because it's something that you could point out to your students, just to be on the lookout for it when, you know, when else does it appear? I think it brings all sorts of harmonic opportunities and options for us as we're working with content. So that's the story behind that. We're still in level two, Alma Mater Blues 2. It's a continuation. Ode to Joy. I love the piece, and actually I included it in the curriculum because it's so well known and so famous. Dog was the very first song that I taught to Wade, the blind boy. And I included it in the curriculum as a shout out to Wade. Wade had a dog, and the dog was called Smalls. That's like the word small, plural, Smalls. And he loved the 49ers, you know, given that he was without sight. He'd never seen a game, but he loved the 49ers. That was his team. And so in the very early stages, when I'm working with Wade, it's like, how do I present the content? But how do I also have some lyrics that he feels that he can connect with? So when I composed Dog, it was with different lyrics. The song was about a dog called Smalls who played for the San Francisco 49ers. And he just thought that was unbelievable, that there was a dog playing with the NFL football team. He just loved that.
Do you still have those lyrics? Can you share them with us?
I don't remember them. Look, remember back then, I had no idea that this was going to be Simply Music. Even after Wade left, I still didn't realize where this was going. It's not like I started teaching Wade and then it was like, oh, Simply Music. It wasn't like that at all. This was something that emerged over a period of time. So when I, it's actually one of the, not a regret, but it's one of the wishes that I had. Wade has no idea of what he contributed and the role that he played in bringing life, music to the life of so, so many people around the world. And I still have it that one day, I had seen his father years later, and his father had said to me that he had become a pretty troubled kid. And it's like, gosh, you know, I wish that I'd had the opportunity. I've done searches on their names, and it's like, do I even remember the last name correctly? I'm not sure, but I wish one day that I could get a private detective to track him down and just acknowledge and thank him for the role he played in Simply Music. Sleeping. That story, that mood, that's a factual story. This is me going into my daughter's room as a baby, watching her sleep. That scenario of the curtains being open, but the see-through fabric. It's like a mesh or something like that. We had sort of like a mesh curtain and then a fuller curtain. The curtains were open, but the mesh wasn't. So it filtered the light as it was coming through the room. That scenario, that's very, very real for me to remember that experience of just watching her sleep. And so that is the story of me talking about my daughter. Light Blue. In the developing of Simply Music, a lot of things were created retrospectively. So I was developing content and presenting it to students. And I had the good fortune of having, you know, many, many students that I was teaching every week. and maybe 120 or 100, a bit more than that. And so I was able to test, to develop some teaching strategies, present them to 30 different students, because I was teaching, I think it was about 125 students teaching privately. I was doing about 65 hours of face-to-face teaching because there were some makeup lessons that I was doing too. And what would happen is I'd develop strategies for song and I'd present it, and I'd present it to 30 different students, all ages and, you know, backgrounds, whatever. And I would learn a lot from that about what wasn't working or what was working. And I'd adjust the way that I was teaching it, and then I'd teach it to another 30 students, and I'd say, wow, this is really a real improvement, but there's still some tweaking that I've got to do, et cetera. I'd alter the strategies. I'd teach it to another 30 students, and it's like, okay, I think I've got this down. I'd do some final little tweaks. I'd teach it to another group of 30 students, and, you know, it didn't matter their age or what their age was or, you know, where they were, they would all get it. And it would be like, okay, I feel like I've nailed that system. And the good thing about that was all of that was happening within 1 week, you know, so every 10 weeks I taught another 1,250 lessons. It was just an unbelievable experience to be teaching, you know, 7,500 lessons per year or something like that. But what would happen oftentimes is I'd get 4 months, 6 months, 8 months down the track, and I would see a consistent issue emerge across students. There'd be some physical thing that they mightn't get, or might maybe a reach that they couldn't get, or there wasn't a fluency that they had with something. And it's like, I need to go back and construct something and insert it at a much earlier stage. And light blue was one of those pieces. I really wanted to work on, this doesn't actually show up until the arrangements, but I wanted to work on that strengthening that finger 2 and 5. I was doing that with my early students. So it wasn't just that, you know, I had that. That whole, that double finger thing, as well as the octave, I was teaching that to students in the early days before I had actually structured Simply Music as a curriculum. The structured curriculum, as you know it, didn't really emerge, or wasn't really released that way until 2002. And so there'd been years prior to that of teaching Simply Music in a far less structured fashion. And so it's way more comprehensive and balanced now than what it was. But I really just wanted a contrast to dark blue, which was already in the curriculum. And it's like, well, it does have the feel of being a much lighter piece, so I'll just call it light blue. That's really, you know, very unsophisticated, but that was where the name came from. Level three, the pipes. I just wanted some cultural diversity. And I just thought it would be funny if I could actually create something that used the drone of 1 and 5. I also just found it humorous that I could create the pretense of having a bagpipe sound on the piano. I just found that amusing. And so nothing more sophisticated than that. But, you know, that's really where it came from. Minuet and G. Pretty much all of the classical pieces in the curriculum, except for a couple, are pieces that I learned as a young child and that I connected with. And apart from being, you know, like part of the classical favorites and valuable, obviously, from the point of view of their, you know, their melodic and harmonic diversity and interest, I just had an affinity to those pieces. So I, you know, wanted those to be included. Fluff Pie, the story behind Fluff Pie is nothing else other than, you know, bear in mind, my relationship with my students, I'm a goof. I mess around with people all the time. And I just find ways to be tolerably annoying to my students. And so with Fluff Pie, what's that, Laurie?
Is it tolerably, huh?
Wow, that, does everyone recognize how rude it is when Laurie's, I mean, here we are engaged in a conversation. Laurie just has to say something that borders on insult. Is there a way that I could possibly insult? Yes, here's an opportunity. I'm going for it. So
learn from the best.
I would create these pieces of music, and I would tell, like, the whole thing about Fluff, it's actually like, hey, I would say to students, hey, if you go into your pockets, like deep down into your pockets, and you dig around at the bottom, you'll pull out fluff, like lint, right? And so a fluff pie is really when you get all of that lint and you just make a pie out of it. And students were like, oh, that's gross. It's like, yep, fluff pie, let's learn that song. So that's all there is to fluff pie. Walking with Billy is another family story. In the early 1900s, there was a global polio epidemic, and the people who were left impacted by that were left either paralyzed for life or brain injured. And my uncle was one of the people who contracted polio, and he sustained a brain injury from that. And he lived with us in our home. My father's father, my grandfather, he died when my dad was like 13. So my dad left school at 13 to become the breadwinner for the family. And so he made sure that his mother, my grandmother, and her son, Billy, who's my dad's brother, they lived with us for our, you know, entire life. So there was the five kids, mum and dad, my grandmother, and my uncle Billy. And he was a good man, and he was a functioning man, but he had behavioral complexities, and his life needed to be structured and managed. But he was good-hearted, really sweet man, and he would often take me. There's a sport in Australia called AFL, Australian Rules Football, the Australian Football League, and it's a unique game. It's not like soccer, it's not like rugby, and it's not like American football. It's a game unto itself. And on Saturdays, you know, there were always games being played in Melbourne, and Billy would and I would walk to the footy, and he had a real deliberateness to his walk. And so there's two songs. Walking with Billy is the story of Billy and I walking to the football, and Billy at the footy, he had a particular way of expressing his enthusiasm. He was very, very vocal. And so in these games, he was always vocal and outspoken, and I would just sort of sit there and watch him amused by his rigorous commitment to unabashed, fully vocalized support for the football team. And I don't know, that was just a shout out to him, both of those pieces. Although the design of that left hand, really was, this is my picture, is me being there as a young child, Billy being there, and him walking with this deliberateness. That's what that tells the story of and depicts. Tear for a Friend. I was about, I don't know, maybe I was in elementary school. I think I was about 8 or 9. And the area that I grew up in was a somewhat of a working class area. And it was at a time when a lot of houses were being bought, pulled down, and apartments were being built, or we call them flats. And as they were being built, the properties weren't wired off or anything, you know, like, you know, gated off. They were just being built. And so during construction, you could just wander through these buildings that were being built. And I remember at one time, I used to play in those all the time as a child. And one time there was a construction inside one of the apartments that had not been finished. And it was a line of bricks, a row of bricks. And it was, you know, just one brick wide and about 4 or 5 bricks across. But it just went straight up. And the intention was to brick it up to the wall, but it wasn't fully bricked up to the wall. And so there was a gap of a couple of feet. And I couldn't quite reach the top of it, but I was with a friend of mine, Jimmy Jones, and we were just playing together. And I went outside. And what happened was Jimmy jumped up and grabbed the very top of the brick to pull himself on, and the wall of bricks came down on him and killed him. And so, it was a very strange, you know, I ran to his parents and told them he'd been hurt. my parents sort of sequestered me inside, and all I know is very late in that evening, my father came in, I woke up, and as he went to bed, and he just said, you know, Jimmy died. So I remember the next day just being in this strange state of, wow, yesterday I'm playing with him and he's no longer here. It was just a confusing state. And I don't really actually remember as a child experiencing it as a sadness. It was more of a strangeness. And Tear for a Friend is an homage to that and to him.
Do you remember how old you were, Neil?
When that happened? About 8.
What was that?
About eight.
Eight.
Yeah. I might have been seven or eight. Yeah. As a family, we did a bunch of things together. Family tree. That's also a shout out to my family. My father was a beautiful singer. He was a tenor. And he and my mother, they just loved music. There was music in our house all the time. So it was being played all the time, or my dad was singing all the time, or he was whistling. He wasn't singing, he was whistling. And then we had a holiday home that we would go to on weekends and, you know, any of the holidays, and, you know, summer, of course, we'd spend a lot of time on the beach. But when we were driving, there would be lots and lots of times where we'd be in the car and Dad would be singing songs and we would just be singing along or harmonizing together to these songs. And the and Family Tree, whilst it doesn't depict the story in the lyrics, really it's about the fondness of the memory I have of that connectedness that we had as a family. It was just a very, very happy time. You know, those times when we'd be in the car and just singing together, I loved that. And that's really what's behind Family Tree. Lead Me to Light, there's not a sophisticated story to that. I was raised a Catholic, and we prayed at every meal. We knelt and prayed together as a family every evening. I was raised by nuns in elementary school, and in secondary school, I was raised by brothers. Christian brothers and Jesuit brothers in two different high schools, but as we call them, secondary schools. Primary school and secondary school was the language in Australia. And then I was an altar boy, and I would do Sunday mass, and I'd also do morning mass, like a 6 a.m. mass at, you know, once or twice a week. And I loved the music. I loved the hymns. And Lead Me to Light is really just, it's just a prayer about nothing in particular, but it really is a prayer, and it's just a musical referencing of just how I felt about the experience of the music that I listened to that was played and sung in church. There's a couple of pieces throughout the curriculum that are an homage and a shout out and a throwback to that.
Was there something that would lead you to write lyrics to some of your compositions and not others?
Yeah, I don't think of myself as being a lyricist. I actually think it's one of my weaknesses. And so it's never really something that I force ever, but if there's something that comes to me, I include it. And if it doesn't, and I feel myself laboring over it, I would just rather not do it. But I also used it as a teaching opportunity where I'd have students writing lyrics. And I found that if I had them write alternative lyrics to lyrics that were there, they were always influenced by those lyrics. Whereas if I didn't provide lyrics at all, you got incredible diversity from students. So I just turned that into a value. But the real reason why they're there or not, I've also, my musical bias is towards the music. And I recall intricate detail of a vast number of songs that I grew up to. And many of these songs were popular songs, and I know exactly what the drums are doing and exactly what fills they're playing. I know what notes the bass guitar are playing. I know what the keyboard or the horn lines are playing. I know the melody of the song. And it will be like, I can't remember one word of that song. My focus was not on the lyrics. My focus was on the music. Whereas my wife, she remembers the lyrics. You know, generally remembers the tune, of course. She's got a really musical ear, but she remembers lyrics more than I do. And it's like, we'll be singing a song, she'll be singing the lyrics, and it's like, oh, I'd never actually heard the lyrics before. And I mean, I've heard the song 1,000 times, and I know every note of every instrument, but just not the lyrics. So, so we get Billy at the footy, and you know, this is one of those things here. If we look at Billy at the footy in the last line there, where it's got we've got that. Let me see here. You can see there in the left hand once again. There's this inner chromatic descending semitone, descending half steps. That's another spot where that appears. The story is just Billy at the footy. And it's not as if this music represents the footy more so than walking with Billy. It's really more a matter of walking with Billy established that walk. And Billy at the footy was just a continuation of the story. And as a result, I just made it a continuation of the piece of music itself. Yeah. You can play a game with your students, you know, where do these descending, this chromatic thing happen in Neil's songs? Deep River, like I said earlier, a lot of my childhood was dark and, you know, and got darker. I had psychiatric help when I was 19. Changed my life. Completely changed the direction of my life. I don't think I'd be here had I not had that. Deep River is one of my favorite pieces of music. And it's one of those pieces where I actually love the lyric. How do I do this? Got it. Just a second. That Deep River flows, nobody watching her. It sounds as though it's the I'm talking about a woman, but I'm really not. That whole thing about nobody seems to care. You know, this I was not alone, and I was deeply loved. And we grew up in a household where I never ever once none of us ever saw our parents argue or fight, because they just didn't. So it was a house that was filled with love. But even so, you know, I don't think anyone escapes life. You know, I had my own inner traumas. And Deep River is really, it's sort of a shout out about that. I mentioned before that we have this holiday home. One of the things that I call it the song's Deep River, but we actually, it was sort of like a creek that fed into the beach that we would visit. And we would fish most evenings at this creek, and the water, it looked like crude oil. It looked so dark. We would fish at in the evenings, you know, it's at sunset and beyond, and so that added to the darkness. So the imagery of the water came from this experience that I had of a child fishing, but the story of nobody watching her, nobody seems to care. That was just how I felt. Knows what she has to do, nobody seems to care. That line of knows what she has to do, there's an ambiguity to that. Because in fact, I really didn't know what to do, but I somehow or other knew that I was meant for something. And that was always a paradox for me. That created great confusion for me. Felt like I didn't belong, but yet I felt like I had purpose. And I did not know how to reconcile that as a child. For as long as I remember, I felt like I had a purpose. And so that's a strange piece for me. The other thing too is when we've got that, I haven't played this in a while, but here it is. This. Once again, in that measure 31 it is. The is once again that same descending, the tension of that just really speaks to me.
And can I interrupt for a second for those that haven't heard that before? That's from level 14. There's a beautiful arrangement of Deep River. That's what Neil was playing.
I really love that piece of music, probably just because it's so, you know, so connected to me and, you know, and where I'm at. Sonata in C, I learned that as a child, the original version. Squidgies Boogie, no comment. Why won't you explain that? Well, it's because I have an agreement. I made a promise to my daughter. She said, just don't talk about that. It's like, okay, but really, she's like, don't talk about that. It's like, okay, well, Dad promised. She knew if she said the word Dad promise, and I promise, she knew that it would be like the vault. So I treat it more as a joke. You know, that whole thing occurred when she was just a little girl. Dark Blue, that had been written before Light Blue and was in the structure of the curriculum, as you know, if you could call it a structure, in the process of the curriculum back then. And I just wanted, I wanted a piece that was darker and that had a whole lot more tension in it. And then subsequently, you know, that really then became the springboard for Light Blue having such a lightness. Musically, they don't really have any correlation, even though one's Light Blue and one's Dark Blue. It's really, that was more just a nomenclature where I just thought I'll just, you know, borrow from the name and lighten up the mood. No real story behind it, but I am drawn towards those minor tensions, and I'm also drawn to those particular chords, you know, where you've got those closely grouped harmonies. I like that.
You know, just about a week ago, I was finishing up Dark Blue with a group of 11-year-old girls, and they just couldn't get over, like, it's not blue. This isn't a blue song. This should be called Dark Jazz. And they were kind of like in this uproar about it. I said, well, you'll have to ask Neil about that one. So,
yeah. Well, I'm like Bishop Street Blues or Jackson Blues or Alma Mater Blues. This isn't Dark Blues. This is Dark Blue. So I did not call it Dark Blues because I didn't want it to be a blues piece, right? Well, then that's like, well, that's a contradiction because Light Blue is blues. And it's like, I know, but I didn't borrow the name in the blues system. That came from me wanting to just lighten up Dark Blue. So I just called it Light Blue. I mean, you know, this is really childish rationale to oftentimes about what's going on in the background to these names. There you have it. In My Eyes, I love this story. I was teaching this song to, I was teaching a song to Chester, this 5-year-old kid. And this kid, he would just be, when I talk, he would just be fixed. He'd be expressionless. And it's almost like he wouldn't blink. He was just so present and he would just take everything in and he would just look at me. And there was one day where I was talking to him and he was distracted. And I said, Chester, you know, look at me. And what do you see? And he looked into my eyes and I'm trying to get his attention. But I said, what do you see? And he said, I see me. And what he meant was he actually saw a reflection of himself in my eyes. And I thought, that's just fantastic. And then I thought, actually, that would be an interesting metaphor. Like, in your eyes, I can see a little part of me. We could actually make it a story more about we're all one. But it didn't come from that. It really came from the humor of one of those things that kids say, you know, out of the mouth of babes sort of thing. So does that make sense what I'm saying? Okay, great. Yeah. I just thought that was beautiful. He's actually just seeing me in the actual reflection. I can see me in you. I like that piece of music too. Let me see. I've only got a few more minutes here and we might have another one of these if anyone wants to and if this is valuable. Shoo-Fly, well, one of the things about Australia that's oftentimes joked about Australia, we have lots and lots of flies, house flies, common flies. And so the Australian wave is just sort of this. And it's not even something that, for the most part, it's not even something that's really annoying, because it's just normal for us to just, like, you know, just to be waving flies away, particularly in summer. And so the idea of shoo fly, that's really just a shout out to shooing the fly off. That actually is what it's about. But the other thing that, if you look at that, I've got that same chromatic rotation happening in the left hand. But the style of rhythm actually came from, I said I'd listened to a lot of music, and there was a song that I'd listened to in 1964 by a band called the New Beats, and it was called Bread and Butter. You get the point? So that whole thing. That whole thing. Dum, bum, 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 bum. Was really influenced by that song from 1964. I just love that. I just thought I would build it into the structure of the song. So
it's also very similar to the original Sesame Street theme.
Ah, I didn't know that. Never saw Sesame Street as a kid.
One of my students pointed that out. Now I hear Sesame Street every single time I hear that song.
Mm-hmm. The Gaz is my brother Gary. So that's just it. It's just my brother Gary. That's where the Gaz came from. So in Australia, we abbreviate things. Like barbecue is Barbie. You know, the same thing, like, you know, Barry would be Baz in Australia. Gary is Gaz. That's just common. So the Gaz, it's not really a that turning it into a noun. It's really him, and it's just a shout out. This whole section here in the later level, it's got the... That's just like the busyness of the fly, of the Aussie fly. So that's why I call it the fly, because it's just like all over the place.
So Neil, are you the Naz or what?
No.
Gordon calls me Laza.
There's no real rhyme or reason what gets abbreviated and what doesn't.
Okay.
It's just some names do, and sometimes they get abbreviated in a way that doesn't really have anything to do with the actual name itself. And yet it's just one of those things that's understood. I don't know.
Gordon Harvey calls me Laza or Loza. I don't know.
Yeah, Laza would be, that'd Laza? Be, yeah, Laza.
Yeah.
Yep. So it's 9:58. I've gotten through most of level 5. If this is something you want to do again, and we'll keep going.
I would love to.
Okay, well, I'll just leave that up to you. We can just set that up. And I hope this was valuable. It's sort of completely
different. Yeah, it really was. Other,
webinar that we've done.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. Get to know you a little bit better through these and through stories. And
yeah, okay.
Fun to hear where they came from. Thank you, Neil.
It's my pleasure. Thanks for giving me your time today. I really appreciate it. And look forward to seeing you again. Thanks for just... Bring music into people's lives. It makes a difference in the world, and it's an honor and a privilege. So, see you soon.
Thanks, Neil. Bye.